the strategy for the strike that I think was that we saw as not very effective was a real dependence on elected officials. To some extent, it felt for a while that we were staging the picket line. That the picket line was a symbolic act. We were withdrawing our labor, and that was important. But like I said before, wasn't enough. And so then, what's next? And we had a number of options. And I think the kind of go-to option from the labor movement and some of the international unions over the last few decades has been to rely on political connections that are built over this relationship that the labor built with the Democratic Party after World War II. And unfortunately, we've seen since the mid-70s that's become quite a one-sided relationship. And that's how it played out in our strike too. There was kind of a constant waiting for Democratic officials at all levels, whether it was a city council person, whether it was a state official, whether it was Hillary Clinton, to kind of come in and put some pressure on NYU to settle the strike. And I think, unfortunately, that we could be repeating, and the point is that didn't happen. They didn't come through for us. We either weren't on the radar enough, whatnot. We didn't depend on our own organizing and our own capabilities and our own ability to obstruct what was going on at NYU. So if we repeat that in waiting for the National Labor Relations Board to be reconstituted under hopefully a Democratic president and hope for them to reverse their decision yet again and require universities to recognize graduate student work as labor and therefore require under the protection of the National Labor Relations Act, we could be waiting indefinitely. And we've really seen historically that that move at the political level comes from the impetus of mass social movements that can't be ignored.
GSOC's history can be read along two different lines on that question. I mean, yes, when we first won the contract, it was aided by an NLRB decision in our favor. And yes, probably, the worst thing that has happened to us is the NLRB decision going against us. And when I talk to friends in Germany or even people here who say, the Democrats and the Republicans, it's all the same, I say, no, actually, I spent months on the picket line because of who Bush appointed and because of the decision they made. So, I mean, on some level, I actually think that the electoral politics has proven to be kind of important. And yes, Bush did make a difference. And the way these protections are being eroded, I think matters. But I agree that we didn't win simply because of the NLRB decision. We had to be prepared before that, and then we had to win a strike vote. We had to be willing to go on strike to actually get them to drop the legal proceedings that they were after and actually negotiate. And we also didn't lose simply because of the legal decision, but because we weren't ready to come out in hundreds for months and withstand the kind of pressure that they put on to us. Part of the irony of our case, I think, that is that NYU has been sort of a job exile for a lot of people in the Clinton administration. So some of the people who ran the anti-union campaign are ex-Clinton officials, which is just another reminder of the fact that you can't rely on liberal elites if you want to build power, win struggles. You have to yourself.
Even when the NLRB was putatively on our side, right, it was still an extraordinarily weak mechanism for ensuring any kind of worker justice, any kind of justice for working people on the job. And so even then, I think that securing and ensuring any kind of workers' rights and any kind of fair labor practices really relies on the ground organizing and on the strength of the networks that workers create and the responses that they're ready to and that we're ready to undertake to employer threats and employer actions. We need to be addressing the university as well as the state in thinking about how we got where we wound up.
The thing, the most interesting thing I've learned about the NLRB is how, even when the law was on our side, how weak the penalties are. So if NYU had decided still not to negotiate and we had then sued them and they had then been found guilty of breaching that law, I understand that the penalty for that, if they are found guilty, is that they put up a sign that says we're sorry.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, that's hard to convey to people. But part of the cost to us of the NLRB decision is the way it demoralizes members more so than the actual material protections it would have provided.
And it certainly served as part of the strike narrative. It certainly served as part of, in the way the media decided to cover it or not, this was, for a lot of people, what made it newsworthy, even if we think it was kind of a red herring issue in a lot of ways. It ended up becoming a big part of the reason that I think we attracted the attention that we did and that we ended up being as high profile as we were during the strike.
Well, one of the things is that it wasn't an act taken in isolation. It was part of a rollback of the definition of who constitutes a worker, who is officially a worker, and then who therefore is afforded union rights. And we see that being eroded in different directions consistently. So it's interesting that I think amongst academics, we keep thinking about and expanding the concept of who is a worker these days. And since the movements of the 70s, housework is work, and scholarship, we've been talking about today, is work. There's a lot of ways that that undergraduates and graduate students are contributing to the value of the university, and the role that the university plays in the general economy. So we're seeing it as broader and broader, and trying to thinking about ways of expanding workers' rights and workers' power at the same time that they're trying to shrink legal conceptions of what is a worker.
What are you, Antonioni or something?